Well, when we did our holiday wrap-up show 2 years ago, I think Elon Musk was a champion of the left. I mean, really, when you think about it, I mean, the Tesla, the electric car company, yep. some of the crazy things that he has done in the world of rockets and, you know, just a different guy. He was on Saturday Night Live, for crying out loud, at one point. But now he's hated by the left. I mean, he is
public
the
enemy number one.
I guess they had to find somebody to fill the void since Donald Trump isn't out there every single day. But he decided to buy Twitter this year. I think he almost immediately regretted it, but then was stuck with the fact that, well, I've kind of made that decision and I filed some SEC papers and I have no other choice but to buy this thing. And now he owns the candy store and he's really not sure what to do with it. But overall, Elon Musk buying Twitter, is America better off with Elon Musk being the chief twit? Dan Joseph.
Not necessarily with him being the chief twit. I think his tweets are a little bit dumb, unsophisticated, to be honest with you. But I think America's better off with his belief that Twitter is a better place when there's free speech allowed, mm-hmm. when everybody's allowed to share their views. And I've sort of evolved on this. You know, at first I was like, well, what about misinformation? What about disinformation? But I think it's a uniquely American thing what Elon Musk is doing by saying everybody is going to have a voice here. We're not going to ban certain people for their political views. That's a positive thing in my mind. And I wish it was some other messenger, but I'm glad that he did what he did.
You even have Jack Dorsey now who's come out and say we were wrong for putting Trump off and doing that type of thing. So I do think what he has done is changed the conversation as relates to what social media should represent, and also in a way of reshaping it, rebranding it. He started off trying to charge people, you know, $8 for a blue check or whatever. And I think he's learning as well. I told Brian at one point I thought he was trying to destroy Twitter, like, you know, crash it down. But I'm not sure now. I think he's trying to reshape it and just do something different with it.
And I think America is absolutely better for having him in charge and having him run the platform. And I think that he's way smarter than people give him credit for. I mean, he is someone that outlines a vision. He is obviously, it's very difficult to track his frame of thinking because he literally is a genius, right? So I think that maybe even a savant, right?
Yeah. Well, exactly.
Savantism, right? So I don't normally get distracted by the stuff that he's saying and doing, right? Because I've been following him since before the Falcon 9 was a thing, and that was his reusable rockets. I watched him crash his first 3 or 4 rockets, and so like I've always watched him as a figure, and I mean, generally when he says that he wants to do something, he gets it done. So if he says he's going to make it a platform for free speech, I think he's going to make it a platform for free speech.
Yeah, he's a person who people will be studying 200 years from now.
Yes.
I mean, he's like a Thomas Edison.
Yeah. He makes parts for his stuff. He doesn't just look at it. He actually makes the things that go into the things he wants.
And he's controversial too now. So he's going to have that. And people remember controversial figures.
Too. Right. And I mean, you know, all of these guys that make these billions of dollars, they're off.
Eccentric.
They're different than we are.
And he's a troll. He trolls people.
And you have to be. I mean, the great athletes are like that. The great musicians are like that. The great artists are like that. The engineers, that they're the same thing. I will say that, you know, I'm with Dan in that. I think the world is better off with him in control, at least his ideology. I don't know if we're better off with Elon Musk being the guy, because I wish he would rather concentrate on rockets and going to Mars and like coming up with some new energy or, you know, whatever, the big things that matter. I mean, look what he's done with the electric car. I mean, he made it cool, right? I mean, and nobody ever thought that was going to be the case. He's the real reason why so many people are into electric cars now. Yeah. And the left now hates him. Like, you can't have it both ways.
Because he became the richest person in the world, number one, they can't stand it unless you check every box like a Bill Gates and set up all these foundations. They can't stand it when you're wealthy.
But the
left, really is that.
The left will stay on Twitter. I know a lot of them initially are leaving, but they're going to stay despite the fact that they hate Elon Musk, and that's a big
win. You mean the same
win.
People said they were leaving for Canada
exactly.
when Trump got
the same
elected.
People
never left?
That's a great call, C4. That's exactly what they're going to do. Yeah. All right, but now we also have learned through the Twitter files that a lot of the stuff that Republicans and conservatives were talking about that was happening on Twitter actually did happen on Twitter with the Twitter files with Matt Taibbi, who's, you know, a liberal journalist, despite the Washington Post literally calling him a conservative.
It's incredible. Mr. Rolling Stone magazine, Matt Taibbi.
I mean,
come on now.
What world are they living in where they describe Matt Taibbi as a conservative?
And Barry Weiss.
And Barry Weiss as well. Used to work for the New York Times.
Yes.
Look, she's more moderate. I can understand people seeing her as a moderate figure.
But she was a Bill Maher regular. I mean, she's in that group with all of them.
Taibbi's not conservative. No. He, if anything, he's a classical liberal journalist, liberal, thinker.
He went after Goldman Sachs during the whole financial crisis, calling them a seven-headed squid dragon, whatever he called them. I'm just saying, he is on that side of the political argument.
My point about all of this is that you literally have NBC News that has a disinformation reporter. Right. And the Washington Post, has like the guy that does the Pinocchios and stuff like that. How can a newspaper like the Washington Post call Matt Taibbi a conservative? Right. Yeah. And you look at them and say, they're not spreading disinformation on a regular basis. Come on.
Because Twitter unrestrained is dangerous to them.
The media is freaking out about this because they've lost one of their main platforms.
Yes.
Social media in general, Silicon Valley has always been a bastion of the left. And they still have Facebook, I suppose. But Twitter's really where the powerful people go and the journalists go to be heard and to be seen to a certain extent. And that's why they're very upset about this. This in the Hunter Biden story, I think it really cracked their armor in a lot of ways, more than people realize.
Well, now, what I just saw was that yesterday was that he is bringing on board Elon Musk, people from Tesla, people from SpaceX. I mean, his creative people into Twitter now, and is going to take. They have sabbaticals, whatever. And I think he's getting ready to do something like fantastic with this by bringing other minds in besides his to deal with it.
Engineers. And it was interesting when you read Jack Dorsey's remarks on this, but he was talking a bit about he had a vision, but then activists got involved. He specifically said things were fine, but then we brought an activist on board. And I think what's going to happen is you're going to have actual engineers working on Twitter that are working to solve problems, that are focused on creating a really solid platform rather than trying to shape the way that people think about things. And that is a fundamentally different thing.
I didn't even know what shadow ban was. Right. I mean,
all of that stuff was happening with activism.
It's to try to shape what people think. It's tried to hide certain opinions. That's exactly what they did. And Tory's absolutely right. Elon Musk is going to change the culture there so it's not run by these activists, so it's not run by the Democratic Party almost directly is what we found out from these story drops.
Do you remember in 2016 when Hillary Clinton said the election was fraudulent because Russian had interfered
on Facebook
with these Facebook $200,000 worth of Facebook ads.
Mm-hmm.
Yet Twitter doesn't, get all of the information out regarding Hunter Biden and doesn't amplify a whole bunch of conservative, viewpoints, bans the New York Post from Twitter altogether. Yep. Does he not have a point, at least, in that there was a major influence? I'm not saying that he would have won, because I don't believe he would have won, even if all the Hunter Biden stuff went out there. But there was certainly an influence, a finger, a thumb
on
that was put on the scales by Twitter and by media during the 2020 election.
Well, I think it undermines the credibility of the media. And that's, I think that's why you're seeing the pushback you're getting, is you're seeing a war right now. It is a war, and whoever wins is going to control information going forward. The conservative, the traditional media, right, the cable news networks and things like that, they know that if Elon Musk is able to set up a foothold and to redefine what mass media looks like, they are gone, like completely irrelevant.
But a lot of them are gone anyway. We just talked about how many of them are losing revenue and what revenue was just 20 years ago compared to what it is now.
It is definitely different.
If they could go back, right, if the people who were running Twitter during the election of 2020 could go back and change something in order to make themselves look less biased, they wouldn't, because their number one goal, the only thing that mattered to them, was getting rid of Donald Trump at the 100%. Time. They would do the same thing over again if they had the chance.
Like, the one thing I like about Twitter is that you can see different views. Now, it can get snarky in kind of a cesspool area, but you can see what a liberal thinks and you can see what a conservative thinks, and you can see those two views. I do worry that even though I'm bullish in some ways, because I think media in general is going to be, people get to pick and choose what they want to do and what they want to see. You want to read something on COVID, then you can go to this particular area. You want to read something on rockets, you can go to that specific area, or policies and stuff like that. But we're going to become fractured, and people are going to go to these different places, and it's only going to be one view.
But Twitter, they do that now, right?
But Twitter is a place where you can see and you can actually have discussions of different views on. That's why I like it, and that's why I think that it is important to survive in the form that it is
now. Within Twitter, people choose silos. Within Twitter, they go to certain places
they want
to go. Exactly. That's what I'm saying. I don't think we're going to turn that part around, but I do think, though, having the overall universe of Twitter and allowing these different voices then does allow, Brian, for what you're saying, but people ultimately are choosing to go in their different little places.
Yeah, but when like a Democratic politician, like when Elizabeth Warren says something that's controversial, she puts it out there in the tweet. When I go read her mentions, I can see people agreeing with her, and I can see people disagreeing with her.
That's
I can
great.
See both sides.
Yeah, I
know.
I think echo chambers are relatively difficult on Twitter, personally.
Yeah, I agree with that, actually. I think that whenever I'm on Twitter, you cannot avoid, no matter how many people you follow or unfollow, you cannot avoid other opinions coming into your feed, especially when it comes to politics.
Most of it is someone retweeting an opinion that they really don't like.
So, I'm talking about who you follow. The people you follow, that's mostly what you get.
Yeah.
Who you follow.
But they're going to retweet things, Tori's exactly right, that they don't like, and they're going to make fun of it. And you're probably not going to like it either, but at least you've been exposed to that different opinion now.
Right.
Whereas if you're watching cable news, you
might
just
have it
all.
Right.
Do you remember, like, in 2010 when you would go on Twitter and there would be, like, a fun little hashtag, like, you know, what's your
Harambe
favorite TV
hashtag
show?
Harambe.
Or, like, you know, ruin a song with one word or something like that.
That's
kind of fun. Do we do that?
Do they really? I don't see a lot of it.
Occasionally. We do what's trending every day on the Tori and Dan show.
You know, it's trendy, but, I mean, do you remember the games that they used to play that it would bring everybody in? Do we still do that anymore?
And I feel like I actually do believe that Twitter is going to get back to that, right? Because a lot of that is algorithms. A lot of it is how you code the application. Right now, social media, most social media, including Twitter, it is currently coded to manipulate the way that you think and approach issues, which is why, I mean, I don't know about you guys, but when you pull up Twitter, about half of it is from stuff that from people that you follow, and the other half is like recommended tweets or someone in your networks liked this thing, and it has nothing to do with you. So, like, I think that as the engineers get in and start unpacking it, my suspicion is it is going to become a very enjoyable platform to be on and a good place to have those discussions. And I think that the engineers at Twitter under Elon Musk's leadership can actually do that.
Hashtag bold prediction there from Tori.
There you go.
No, we'll get to the other bold
Twitter
predictions
will be fun.
make Twitter great again.
Make it great.
Coming up next, we'll turn our attention to the sports world, the Orioles and Ravens, and some other things as well going on in World Cup, maybe, as well. That's on the way next. Talk Stars coming up. You don't like that? You don't like soccer, Dan? Come on.
He's notorious.